Yadunayak, Mr. Vyas, Mr. Patel, Mr. Gohil, friends, Yadun Bhai has been very kind to me. And you?
I'm normally not that patient and calm, frankly. People I bump into in the foyer of a hotel. But there was certainly something about him that persuaded me to stop, listen, talk. And I knew that he was a man who had something substantive to say, a man who had achieved much, and more important, was destined to achieve more. Today I've discovered that he is an excellent host, not because of the very nice hotel he's provided me and so on, but because he exaggerates in his praise. And believe me, between exaggerating the praise and underestimating you, I will always take exaggeration. He not only commanded me to come, but he has also commanded me to speak on the subject that he thinks I should speak on. And the subject is how to think differently. The phrase "think differently" is a bit of a tautology. A tautology is means that it's repetition. If you think at all, you will think differently. To understand the meaning of a word, one way to understand the meaning of a word is to understand what the opposite of it means. So what is the opposite of think? Non-thinking? No. Non-thinking is non-activity. What is the opposite of think? The opposite of think is thoughtless. When you don't have a thought at all. The moment you have a thought, you will understand the purpose of that thought. What is the purpose of thinking? The purpose of thinking is essentially to take you from point A to point B. Now, we have very often been trapped in something called education. I use the word advisedly because education is not always knowledge. Very often education is knowledge. But it is not always knowledge. Because education also, and has to be, because education is a mass science. The moment you create a mass science, you search for the lowest common denominator, not the highest common denominator. And therefore education can also, you know, take shortcuts. Right? As the best, I'm not criticizing education, I'm merely explaining it. So, we have been taught, the science of mathematics teaches us, famously from the Greek, I think Pythagoras, somebody said, that a straight line is the shortest distance between two points. And that we are so transfixed by that thought, because it is clearly something useful, it's straight, which impresses our innate moral attitude. Straight is far better than crooked. Right? Even those who are crooked talk of being straight. They take a straight line to the banks to collect NPS. So if the straight line impresses us, but the challenge in order to travel from A to B is not to find the straight line, but to find the most efficient line. Quite often the straight line is the most efficient line. But very often the straight line is not the most efficient line. Why? Because the straight line is straight, and because it's the shortest, and because we are impressed by what is the shortest, we forget that everybody else is equally impressed by the shortest. So on that straight line, you'll be a traffic jam, which instead of taking you to the airport in 15 minutes, will take you to the airport in an hour and a half. So therefore, in that particular case, the straight line is not the most efficient line. All street and urban planning is done on this basis. All urban planning is done on the basis of coefficiency, not on the basis of straight. There are two highways out from here to Gandhinagar. Why do you need two? You need two because the coefficients of the two highways are different. And that is the importance of thinking. Thinking actually presumes something extremely important. It doesn't presume that you're ignorant. It presumes that you have the humility and the ability to think your way through rather than take something as a given fact. That's the difference, and that is the important. Now, please, thinking is very different from dreaming. Dreaming is quite another activity. Very often when you're lost in dreams, you think you're thinking. You're not thinking. You're fantasizing. It is important to fantasize. If we didn't fantasize, we wouldn't be where we are. In my own life, when I started life in a very small town called Tellipara, it's actually a jute mill colony rather than a town. And I was born on the wrong side of the jute mill, not in the officers' quarters of it, but in the working class quarters. My grandfather was a very efficient man, and instead of remaining working class, he built one or two houses or something of that sort. And so we were not starving at any moment, but our world was that. And I was in that small street and, lucky to get into school and then fortunate to get into Presidency College. I spent a lot of my time fantasizing. But fantasy is only a spur. Fantasy is not the way forward. And I tell you, in whatever aspect, in whichever aspect, you can take almost anything. And once you start thinking, you will find something completely different. Yeah, there are two pens here. They actually coincidentally also managed to look alike. Yeah? One costs, I don't know how much, 20 rupees. The other, I won't tell you the price, it's embarrassing. Right? Both write. Which writes better? This one. Why do I carry this one? Because this is not a pen, it's male jewelry. Right? And that is what thinking will take you to the accurate position. This watch I have, there's a mobile phone gives me free time. I'll know the exact time, accurate time freely. I don't have to wind it and do a place or something. Why do I wear it? Because it's male jewelry. Unfortunately, I can't ever think of a third thing which is male jewelry. maybe cufflinks. Yeah. Maybe. But all I'm trying to say is that the moment you think, what is this? It's a bottle of water? No, it's not a bottle of water. It's a bottle of trust. It's not water at all. Do you think you drink this in order to survive? 0.0005% of India drinks this in order to survive. 99.99995 has no concept of this water. Those people live as long as you and probably longer. After all, unfortunately, they don't eat as much, and because they don't eat, they don't get ill. This is evidence that the upper middle classes have lost their faith in government. This is what this means. We no longer trust the water that the government provides. I think till the age of 40, we all drank nothing but tap water. It didn't kill us. If anything, the law of progress tells you that even if the tap water in India is bad, it still is better than what it was in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Even if it is bad. So the tap water then was actually certainly not better than what we get today. If anything, it was worse. But this product has been created out of marketing. Completely out of marketing. This also is middle class jewelry. We like to keep it in front of us as a sign that we have reached some status. And if you think, you will find that, you know, suddenly the same thing doesn't look quite the same. You ask me to think differently. I can ask you, what is this award that you are giving these bright young people for? And you will give an answer that you are giving these bright young people awards for something that they have done. I tell you, that is totally wrong. You are not giving them awards for what they have done. You are giving them awards for what they are going to do. This award is to help them become the scientists you want them to become. That is the purpose of any award. And that is what I mean. When you start thinking, you will always think differently. You will always think differently. I can take you into almost anything, and tell you that the other day we were discussing in some place, you know, the wars raging on in all the world. Just as an example. And I pointed out that, look, war, death, killing has been part of our existence from long before, I think from the beginning of human existence. Please don't mind that I'm not saying this any personally, but you did mention a phrase that we use conventionally, that we are a 5,000-year-old civilization. I think everybody uses it. Were we uncivilized 5,001 years before? We were not. So where did this term 5,000 years come from? It comes from some different fact. The different fact that this is 5,000 years is about the only time we can come to some reasonable understanding of our history. But since we don't have the courage to admit that we are ignorant about 10,000 years ago, we will assume that anyone before 5,000 years was uncivilized. Human beings have been in existence for millions of years. What is so special about the last 5,000 years? I can go into anything. I can go and look at Taj Mahal, I can look at the pyramids. And I look at them, and then I am told, again in the education which I said is I am told that gravity, we owe the knowledge of gravity to Isaac Newton. Isn't it? Isn't that? I mean, I am very bad at science, but aren't we told that? Do you think the pyramids were made without understanding gravity? Do you think you could make the gumbas of the Taj Mahal without understanding gravity? what they understood and their scientific camp, pyramids are now 5,000 years old, 7,000 years old. We have not been able to preserve their knowledge. But why should we dismiss it? Again, I'm not saying that thinking will lead you to any certainty. The good thing about thinking is not that it gives you answers. The good thing about thinking is that it keeps creating questions. And questions really are far more creative than answers. Without questions, you will never ever go anywhere. And so, as I was mentioning, war and peace, very vital issues for any in governance and so on. I said, you know, I think war has been a fact of existence since any, you know, whatever times you can think of. And the search for peace has equally been a fact of existence ever since human beings emerged into some kind of rational space. So look at something interesting. The meaning of peace has not changed from the Upanishads or from the Bible or from any of the ancient texts. The meaning of peace remains the same. It is the meaning of war which changes. So if you want to look for peace, you have to search for the meaning of war. You have to search for the rationale of war. Then only will you be able to get the reasons or the answers that give you peace. Then one more aspect, and that is thinking ahead. Thinking for the future, thinking ahead is an important variation of thinking. Thinking ahead is perhaps the most difficult thing to translate into decisions, because very often it is dismissed as too radical, because it is too, sometimes it becomes even too dangerous to think that. And that is why it's often said that prophets, you know, no man is a prophet in his own land, because people find it difficult to understand. And a very good example which Ketan Bhai asked me to mention is one of my columns recently about a decision that Gandhiji made in 1946. Well, he did come to it. In 1946, one of his associates, disciples, called Chakraya. Chakraya was a Dalit from Andhra Pradesh who had come to Sevagram the day Sevagram started, and then lived with Gandhiji all through. And he was a young man, he came, he was also a very good craftsman. And Gandhiji also began to like him like a son. And Chakraya died of a sudden brain tumor or something, it was brain tumor. In 1946, and Gandhiji, of course, was very upset, you know. And he said, you know, I don't even have tears anymore. And then Gandhiji came up with a startling idea, because, you know, the thought of the first government was already in the air, and it was going to come, interim government. And he turned around and he said that the very first president of India, not the Prime Minister of India, Prime Minister of India is an executive authority, in any case, he had named the future Prime Minister of India, and he had done it 4 years before. That was Jawaharlal Nehru. But he said, the President of India in the new republic, and he knew what the meaning of president would be, it would not an executive head, but the ceremonial head of state, the President of India should be a poor Dalit. And if Chakraya had been alive, I would have insisted that be President of India. Now that Chakraya is dead, I want a girl. I want a poor, honest, Dalit girl to be the first president. Let her sit in that palace. And what did that great generation of Congress leaders do? They ignored him completely. They did not even discuss it in their own memoirs. He called Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who would, as you know, become the first president, and mentioned this. And he says, I know your hesitation. You give her the staff, you give her the secretaries who will formulate whatever the requirement is, but make it. He was just thinking too far ahead. He was thinking of a time when class distinctions and caste distinctions could both be eliminated. He was thinking of sending out a powerful signal, a symbolic signal to the future. But it is almost impossible for anyone to accept. And you can't blame. I mean, let's not get caught in this nonsense of blaming people. You have to understand people. Don't blame them. But it is thinking ahead which brings me to the subject that I had prepared for. This is the month of May. In the month of May, 2 years ago, Gujarat lost a chief minister and India gained a prime minister. And 2 years is, I think, a good moment at which to try and understand what the government is doing and where it is headed. And I don't want to get, you know, the foreheads on which a prime minister at least is judged would be the economy, of course, number one, domestic peace, number two, foreign policy, number three, infrastructure, I suppose, number four. And on all these, you know, I mean, you're familiar with. I just want to talk about one aspect of it, and that is the economy. Because I find that people are of the, what would you say, of the class which should get it, people are find it very difficult to understand precisely what is going on. I think there is a growing sense of feeling that yes, something is happening, but what precisely is happening? And the reason is because this economy, this new Modi model, which I call Narendra Modi's new economy, is a classic example of thinking ahead. When he came, first, please understand that there is no text without context. When he came, became Prime Minister in 2014, please try and understand the India at that moment. Of course, it was an India ridden with corruption. Of course, it was in India. But for me, and I think for judging by what the Prime Minister said in his very first speech, all these were very important problems and they had to be sorted out. But what was the critical problem? What was the critical problem which we faced and which, if we did not sort out within the foreseeable future, would lead to a crisis of dimensions which I cannot describe. It would lead to disorder of a kind that we have not witnessed in our lifetimes. When we see today some things occasionally go right, I mean, we live in a volatile democracy, so nothing will go right all the time, but consider what could have happened before you, even as you consider what has happened. The great challenge before was this. In 1950, when our planning commission and our economic policies started getting better and government became stable, we got a constitution. India had, it is not the correct numbers are not estimated, but India had about 70%, 65% of people living below the poverty line. Today, according to all statistics, that figure is about 32% or perhaps, let us say, sometimes statistics are wrong, it's 35%. Let's say from 70% to 35%. Now, if you and I, both of us, who have had three meals a day and have not had a fourth meal a day only because our doctor has told us you have a fourth meal a day and you go to hospital, we look at these statistics and say, very good, very good. We were 70%, look at where we have become, we've gone down to 35%. Think, this is the way we look at it. How do the people who are within that 35%, how do they look at it? What are they thinking? You know what 35% of India is? 35% of India is 400 million. 400 million is one and a half, well, certainly one and a half times the population of America. 400 million is a huge, huge number. And what is our poverty line? Our poverty line is a line of hunger. Our poverty line is a line of hunger. We have not faced hunger. None of us in this room know the meaning of hunger. And we cannot know it. 400 million people, you know what they are asking? And if actually you took the leg, the people who are in the marginal belt, who are technically outside the poverty line, and I tell you something like 500 to 550 million people go every day to bed uncertain whether they are going to eat tomorrow. That is the level of uncertainty in their minds, in their hearts, in their thinking. Think, they are not thinking about 10 years ahead whether my child will become a graduate or win an award. They are thinking, how will my child survive tomorrow? And what are they saying? They are saying that if it took you 70 years to bring it down from 70% to 35%, is it going to take you another 70 years to bring 35% down to zero? You may have 70 years to wait to bring it to zero, they don't. They will not, and why should they? If we do not eliminate this 35% within the next 10 years, and we had before that, and I don't want to sound partisan because this is not a political state, and I do not, but trust me, look at the statistics. Before that, we had 10 frozen years. Frozen years. Because instead of solutions to our cancer, we were only offering band-aid. And this was the challenge in the very first speech the Prime Minister made. And I think many people were startled when he said this Parliament made up. The first thing he said was, the era of poverty alleviation is over. Poverty alleviation is a phrase in our constitution, by the way. And you could, and obviously people didn't understand what it meant. He said the era of poverty alleviation is over, the age of poverty elimination has begun. He shifted the whole perspective. Alleviation is what I would call a tolerant approach. Elimination is understanding poverty. Now, you can have an objective. How do you go in? Think. Think differently. Think differently. What is the solution? As long as there is such extreme poverty, there will always be discrimination in favor of the poor. There will always be subsidies. You cannot remove them. Nobody in this census can remove them. But that is not the solution. The solution is what? The solution is creating an economy for the poor. not making them dependent, but creating an economy for the poor. So, how do you create an economy for the poor? The best way to create an economy is to create an economy of jobs. So where are the jobs going to come for the poor? Where are the jobs? Then came the second step. Not many people understood it. And he said that we have to move away from the binary. This is really thinking. We have to move away thinking differently. We have to move away from the binary of the private and the public sector. And he suggested a new sector called the personal sector. What is the personal sector? The personal sector is a sector which in the first time, so far for 70 years, governments have come, governments have gone. And I sincerely believe that every government wants to help the poor. It doesn't matter which party you belong to, because it's inhuman not to help the poor. And why should I consider any government to be inhuman? But for the first time, we have got a government, and this is the government of Narendra Modi, which not only wants to help the poor, but it also trusts the poor. And please understand, there is a huge difference between helping the poor and also, plus, trusting the poor. Trusting the poor with what? Trusting the poor with opportunity, and then creating the fiscal means through which you can convert opportunity into reality. It means that the thela wala who is selling vegetables outside, or the village Nai Baba, he is also doing a business. Business is not being done only by people with turnovers of 5,000 crores or 7,000 crores or even 500 crores. Business is also being done by somebody who needs a daily turnover of 5,000 rupees. That is also business. And that is where the poor are. In fact, the person who is doing a business of 5,000, 10,000 rupees per day turnover is actually among the richer of the poor. And therefore, what? He said, now, this is not going to be possible without fiscal empowerment. How do I create fiscal empowerment? You can give handouts. Is that fiscal empowerment? No. If you give it in cash, cash has a tendency to breed corruption. All the statistical figures that you can come out of Manrega's experience and so on show there is 50% which goes in corruption and wastage, if not more. Very often it is 60%. So, and even higher than 60%. So you first create a banking system which belongs to the poor. You nationalized banks in 1969 by saying you were doing it in the name of the poor. From 1969 to 2019 is probably 60 years. You're over 50 years or something. For 50 years, banks which were nationalized in the name of the poor haven't seen what those banks are. For 50 years, the poor have been searching for banks. Today, for the first time, banks are searching for the poor. They're not doing it very willingly because discomforts are involved. My relationships are involved. They have relationship managers for my account. They don't have relationship managers for the impoverished. First time. Once, it took a while. Nobody believed that Jandan would ever succeed. I remember the arguments we used to have on television and the other party leaders sneering. Arey, usme to kuch paisa nahi hai. And I said, totally frustrated, don't you understand this is the first time a banking system has been created for those precisely without money. It is meant for them. And not only for without money, you have added 5,000 rupees insurance for them. So there is an implicit overdraft. And then, I'm taking it just logically but quickly forward. Only once when you achieve that, because that now becomes a basis for financial security, for insurance security, for health security, because now there is a basis on which you can extend the services that had gone towards up to the middle class in India and take them to far. Insurance, security. But then comes the most important aspect of it. It is a scheme called Mudra. It's very interesting, and I was speaking on the subject when seconding the motion for the president's debate. I was amazed at the lack of awareness of Mudra. In the first year, the government has allotted 100,000 crores to Mudra. In the second year, this year, 180,000 crores. Our total spending is about 17 lakh crores. It's a very significant amount of money. I asked my editor friends, you know, colleagues, I said, please criticize it, or whatever you have opinion, but why do you completely avoid it? Nobody mentions it in the newspaper. Nobody mentions it in media. Why? I don't like it, say it's wrong. Like it, say it's right. Why don't you mention it? You know, there is a rational answer. And I said, I don't believe in conspiracy theories by media. You know, editors compete with each other so much, they have no time for conspiracy. But there has to be, the rational answer exists, that this money is not meant for newspaper reading. This money is not meant for television only. It is below the radar of media. If the same thing had been allotted for viewers of television and this thing, they would have discussed it every day. So, what is the mudra? The mudra scheme is your ability to take money from 10,000 rupees, 20,000 rupees loans, right? Up to, I think, without collateral. But it has to be a logical loan. It has to be paid back. Now, I'm sure it's not going to be perfect. But for the first time, money is available. You know, one of the biggest creation of jobs, chicken farming, goat farming, sewing machines, small shops. What is the principle? The principle is that if, let us say, you know, 2 crores, 20 million people have been able to create micro businesses, if they give one extra job each, job creation is not creation of only 1,000 jobs per unit. Job creation can also be 2 jobs per unit. That if you have managed to create 1, 2, 3 jobs, you will be then addressing the need for jobs at the level where it is needed most. And that's it. Now, therefore, what we are seeing is progress on 2 economies. One is a conventional economy. I mean, you know it because you've experienced it.